Yeah, hi everyone. This is Jaydeep here. If you can hear me, please let me know. Am I audible?
Hi Jaydeep, this is Hima.
Hi
here.
Jaydeep.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, we can hear you.
All right, thank you so much. We have a couple of participants who won't be able to join. As we mentioned earlier that we'll be recording this webinar and the same recording will be shared with everyone. But thank you for joining and taking out time. And first of all, thanks for applying to be part of this Women Leaders Expedition. We are really excited and looking forward to having every one of you in Ladakh in the month of October. The way I would like to structure this webinar is basically take you through all the details of where we are going, what is the day-by-day itinerary going to look like, and then towards the end, I'll open it up for question and answer with regards to how the weather is going to be, with regards to the care, with regards to the medical and everything else. So if you can just park your questions till the end, that'll be great so that we can collate and then answer all the questions. And roughly the webinar should last around half an hour to 45 minutes. So that's about it. And I'll begin with that. So can everyone see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay. So the expedition is to electrify the nunnery of Skit Mung Fu. And in this picture, you can actually see a visual of how the nunnery looks like when you get the first view of it. The nunnery, more about the nunnery. So the geographic location, now when you look at the map of India, we will be in the northern part of India in the state of Jammu and Kashmir in the region of Ladakh. Now people get confused when they hear Jammu and Kashmir because it is known for we have Pakistan and China as our neighbors, and there's a lot of violence that happens in the Kashmir Valley. But please don't get alarmed by that, because we are in the safest part of India, in fact, which is the region of Ladakh. And within Ladakh, if you look at the map here, this is Leh. This is where you fly in from Delhi, and from Leh we go south into a place along the Indus River, into a place which is called the Changthang region. Now, most of you would have heard about Pashmina, the Kashmir, the shawls that are made, the wool, that the best Pashmina comes from this region of Ladakh, which is called the Changthang region. So we are essentially going to the Changthang region, and this is where the Skit Mung Fu Nunnery is located with regards to its location. Now, the total journey from Leh is roughly around 130 kilometers. Now the Skit Mung Fu Nunnery is not on Google.
Jaydeep, just 1 second. Hello?
Yeah?
I couldn't see the full screen. I can see the only half of the screen somehow. What about the others? I don't know.
Same here.
Yep, same here.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Hang on. Can you see the full screen now?
No, just half of the slide expedition. That's it. And the other part is not.
Okay. Has it been like this from the beginning?
Yes.
I think so. That's the problem. Is it okay now?
Yeah,
that's good now.
Yes. Okay, so I'll start from beginning. Sorry about that. Thanks for correcting. And so now you can see. So let's start again. Now this is the Skit Mung Fu Nunnery. The first view of the nunnery that you will get. Now, essentially what a nunnery is where the female Buddhist monks, they live and practice Buddhism. So this is the geographic location. So in India, like I mentioned, we'll be in the northern part of India in the region of Ladakh. And within Ladakh, If you see the red dot, Leh is where you will land from Delhi or Mumbai. And once you land in Leh, we go south into the valley along the Indus River to a region called the Changthang region. And the Skitmangfu Nunnery is located somewhere here. Of course, it is not on Google Maps. So the nearest point that you can find in Google Maps is this area called Kidmang, which is actually Skidmang, but it has been on Google Maps, it is as Skidmang. So it's roughly 130 kilometers from Leh. And Google Maps, of course, does not account for the bad road conditions. So it shows you 2 hours, 49 minutes. But roughly, this will be a 4 hour journey. And once we reach Kidmang, after that, we get into the valley. And roughly, it will be a 1 hour trek, 1 to 2 hours trek, to reach the monastery of to reach the nunnery of Skitmang. So it is a 500 year old nunnery, and in the Changthang region. And there's also an ancient cave that has been found in the nunnery, which is used for meditation. So when nuns have to go into deep meditation, it is at that time they just go into the cave, no contact with the outside world for a year or two, and they meditate in that cave. It is the most remotest and backward nunnery because of its distance from the road. And so what happens is once the nunneries are off the roadhead, there's hardly any development or any help that reaches these nuns. And also within the society, within the Ladakh society, traditionally monks have had a higher place as compared to nuns. And if I trace back the history of nuns, the families initially used to give any girl child who was not who had like a deformity or was not mentally stable, those women used to become nuns initially, because the family was they just gave those children away to religion. But now, of late, in the past 10, 20 years, there's been a lot of, strong movement by the local nun association to improve the place of nuns in the society. And as a result, what we are seeing now is that more and more girls who are well-educated and have the right skills are now becoming nuns to propagate Buddhism. And also, the place of nuns is, being regarded and improved in the local society. Now, this nunnery is home to 15 nuns and who has more than 40 rooms. And there's also a primary school for these small nuns. So the small girls that are given away by the families to become nuns, they also are, they come here. And there's a primary school with roughly 14 students. And luckily, the nunnery has a satellite phone, which is the only way for them to connect with the outside world. Now, the overall expedition journey is going to be 280 kilometers back and forth. So it is roughly, like I said, 4 to 5 hours by vehicle from Leh to the Skitmang village. And then from then on, we trek for 2 hours into the valley for roughly 3 to 4 kilometers to reach the nunnery. We will be staying in the nunnery for 3 nights. And again, we might decide to camp, or we might stay inside the, there are some rooms in the nunnery where we might decide to stay, depending on how cold it gets in the valley. Because the nunnery is located into a valley, it might get really cold. So we there's a good chance we will be staying inside the permanent structures in the nunnery and not camping. And we will have horses from the village carrying the material to help the nuns. So that's how we are transporting our solar grid material. And the average altitude of the journey will be stable at 11,500 feet. So Leh itself is at 11,500, and the nunnery is of, almost at the same altitude. So that's on the logistics part of it. So this is how the trekking is going to look like. It will be in a valley. There is a gradient and it's uphill. So from the village, we trek all the way slightly uphill to reach the nunnery. But it is a gradual gradient. So that's why we can we'll walk slowly and at leisure, enjoy the beautiful scenery and end up reaching in 2.5 hours from the roadhead to the nunnery. Now, so these are some more visuals of the Skitmangfu nunnery from the time that we surveyed this nunnery. And the room that you see on the left-hand side, so this is how typically the room of the head nun, where she preaches and gives away teachings. So that's her, the nun is called a Rinpoche. And there is a good chance, almost it's almost confirmed that we will have the head nun of this monastery also be there by, at the time we are electrifying the nunnery. So it is considered to be a blessing. You can say that the head nun, who's a very learned and very well-educated nun, she will be there. And then on the right-hand side, you can see the small nuns. So all nuns are supposed to they keep their heads shaved. And so these are small little girls who have been given away by their families to become nuns. And it will be great for you all to also understand, you know, from the kids, little kids, as to, you know, what does this mean for them? What does it mean for them to be staying away from their families and to choose the path of religion? And it is both ways. So sometimes the parents give away, sometimes the girls actually ask themselves that they want to become a nun and they leave their homes. So it is a very interesting perspective that, you know, we get to know about what really drives these kids at such a young age towards being a nun. And these are some more nuns. And on the right hand side, you can see the scriptures. So these are ancient Buddhist scriptures, written in the local language. And the nuns, they, you know, memorize all these scriptures. And the more you memorize, the higher in the hierarchy you're able to go based on the memorization that you do. So a Rinpoche, or the head nun, would have memorized many such scriptures. And these are very old. Some of them have come from Tibet. Some of them are from local, you know, resources, but really very old scriptures. And so there are 50 nuns who are working towards their spiritual journey and, of course, promoting Buddhism in the local region. So this is the work that we will be doing. So once we reach the nunnery, we'll be dividing ourselves into teams. And the whole idea would be to first survey the entire nunnery to identify where all the lights will be required, how many light bulbs will be put up, how many grids are required. And based on those surveys, we'll then begin our work of setting everything up. And the best part about the technology, which is DC solar microgrids, is that it is very easy to install. So you don't need to be an engineer. You don't need to be an electrical engineer or any background whatsoever. You just have to have the will and courage to come to the nunnery. And the rest, we'll make you an engineer on that very day when we begin our installation. And you will realize how simple the technology is. And the whole idea is the technology has to be really simple, because ultimately the local people are going to take care of it. They are going to be, and they should be able to understand it. They should be able to troubleshoot it. Because if they are not able to, then there's no point of having technology to empower them. So that's why the technology part is very simple. And it's something that we'll explain to you more when you are on the ground. In the nunnery. Now, this is a day-by-day itinerary. On 12th October, you will arrive in Leh, and this is the day of acclimatization. Now, what happens is, from the places we live in, we are almost close to sea level, and then suddenly in 1 hour, when you come by a flight, you gain 12,000 feet. Now, when you gain such altitude, your body needs time to get used to the new surroundings and to the new area which it is in. And so that's why day one of 12th October is all about acclimatization. You will be received by our team at the airport. And post that, we'll just take you to the hotel and get you to rest. So the whole day would be basically keep sipping lots of water, because that is the best way to acclimatize, because water also contains dissolved oxygen. And so it increases your oxygen levels, because Ladakh, the oxygen carrying capacity of your body reduces to almost 70% of what it was at sea level. So that's why it's very important to provide as much oxygen to the body as possible. And so drinking water is the best way to do that. Besides, of course, trying to take in as much oxygen as possible. And so the whole idea would be, once you come from hotel, you rest, get up, have lunch, rest, get up, have dinner, rest. So that's the day one for you. No work at all. And we will have connectivity in terms of Wi-Fi, hopefully. Sometimes it does not work, but more or less now you will get Wi-Fi, and you will be staying in a hotel, so you get you will have heated rooms, and you'll be having access to a hot shower. Day two, we will begin slowly. We will be in Leh city, and we'll take you around the and give you an idea of what area you are in. You know, how remote it is, and what is the development that is happening in this area. And then we'll take you to the old city, we'll take you to some of the prominent places of this Leh city, and also get you to meet some of the local stakeholders, including some government officials, or some female change makers. In fact, the deputy commissioner, the local, the head of this region is a young IAS officer who's a female. And so we are trying to see if she can come down and have a word with you, all of you, to just share her perspective on how she's looking at development in this region, and what her journey has been, because it's really inspiring, and the kind of work she's been doing is really amazing. And more that we'll share once you're there. So that's day two, local heritage and day city tour. On day three, we will begin with some biking, and this is, we are not going to climb any mountains. This is on flat roads, slightly uphill gradients and downhill gradients, but the whole idea is to open up your bodies to this new atmosphere you are in, and also enjoy the scenery, because it's just a beautiful sight, biking in the Himalayas. And we will also take a look in terms of, if you're not comfortable doing this, you can of course sit in a van and cheer up the other participants who will be biking. So this will be of course optional, but it would be great to have everyone bike. And then once the biking is done, we will come back to the hotel, have a bath, and then leave for a nearby village where we have set up our homestays, where the entire model of sustainability comes into play. So GIG first electrifies a village, and then those electrified villages are promoted as tourism homestays, which actually puts these villages on the tourism map, and also allows villagers to earn income by through the travelers who come to these villages and experience the local culture and heritage. Now, if you really want to experience Ladakhi culture, you cannot do it in Leh, because that is all touristy. But if you go to these villages, you actually get to experience the authentic Ladakhi culture and traditions. And so we'll take you to one of these villages and then get you to experience the culture and tradition, and also showcase how we are building in the sustainability model for these electrified villages to be able to maintain and scale up the grid infrastructure, and also to improve their livelihoods. And so we'll go to such a homestay and then again come back to Leh. So day three, you will be in Leh, staying every day in Leh in a hotel. So Wi-Fi connectivity and shower facilities are available. Now, from day four onwards, we'll leave from Leh to Skitmang. And this is basically the end of Wi-Fi connectivity and the end of hot showers. So once we are in the Nandri, there won't be any shower for 2 to 3 days. Because it is really cold, and we won't recommend taking a shower in those cold areas. Anyway, we leave from Leh and we reach the Nandri of Skitmang, and it will be roughly the whole day, because 3 to 4 hours on the road, and then a 2-hour trek to the Nandri. And once you reach the Nandri, you will be welcomed by the nuns in their traditional form. And what you can see is a picture of the villagers doing a welcome. So this is how the villagers welcome. They have jugs in their hands, which are basically of the local beer, and they have the white silk scarves, which is called a khatak. So we, of course, in the Nandri, you won't see the local beer, but Kathaks is by which you will be welcomed in the Nandri. And yeah, just enjoy and just soak in this experience and relax, because it would have been a long day of travel. And so that marks our entry into Skatemang. Of course, we will be connecting with all your loved ones through email. So the Nandri has a satellite phone. And through that satellite phone, we'll be sending, we'll be updating our team in Delhi with all the information. And our team in Delhi will be sending out a mail to 11 email ID that we'll take from you, and just updating, you know, the team whereabouts, and if there's any special message you can send across. Now, day 5 is when we begin our work. So the day will begin with first doing a survey of the entire Nandri. Going into each and every room, going into the main prayer halls, going into the special rooms that the Nandri has. And then, you know, based on that, we do a survey, how many light bulbs, how many solar grids. And once we come up with those calculations, we'll begin our work of first putting up the bulb holders in the rooms, then setting up the solar panels on the roofs, and then, of course, doing the wiring and everything. So this will roughly take the entire day. And also, we'll have some meditation sessions with the nuns, so that it is a way for you all to detach from everything that you know, you are surrounded by in your daily work, and just being able to meditate and focus on yourself as a person and your surroundings. So, I mean, that's the whole idea, that besides being a electrification journey, this also becomes a transformative journey for each and every one of you, because once you get detached from all the distractions in the world, there's a lot that you get to know about yourself, and you gain a lot of perspective about yourself as an individual. And then day 6, of course, will be very special, because this is the day that you know, we'll be doing the finishing touches in the village, in the Nandri. And also, what we will do is, if anyone is interested, if some of you are interested, there's a nice hike from the Nandri to the top of the mountain that is behind the Nandri. So we might go on a hike early morning and you know, get you to a top mountain pass and experience the wonderful views from there. And then, of course, come down later and finish up the electrification work. And then just wait for sunset to happen, because that's when magic happens, and we finally switch on the lights. Now, the way, you know, the reactions, what I can share is from the villages, where people just start dancing, people start crying, and I'm not sure how it would happen in the Nandri. And so this is something really special for us also. And it will be very unique in terms of the emotions that flow in. And so I think before I mean, I wouldn't like to add anything else here, but just soak in the experience of, you know, how when a group of strong women leaders get together and they decide to do something, and then what is the kind of impact you can really create, a tangible impact on these local communities. So just soak in the experience, and I think it will be really special. It will be a really special moment for all of us to finally bring light to the Nandri. And on day 7, you know, that's when we start heading back to Leh. And this is the day again you get back to your hot showers and Wi-Fi, and you get connected to the outside world. But I'm not sure after the meditative journey and in the Nandri, how many of you would like to get back to Wi-Fi and get connected? But yeah, so we get back to Leh on 18th October. You will be staying in hotels again, and it will be a roughly a full day journey. The route is beautiful. You can see a picture, and it will be just you know, a nice route along the Indus River. And yeah, so once we get back to Leh, on the day 8, what we will do is take you all to visit the Pashmina factory. So the entire Pashmina wool from Ladakh comes to a factory in Leh, where it is where the hair and the Pashmina fiber is separated. So it's a manufacturing plant, but we'll take you through it and explain how, what Pashmina is, how does it work, What does it, how much do the villagers get? So you get to understand the handicraft part of the entire supply chain. And then towards the evening, we'll go to the lay market for all of you to buy souvenirs and take back certain things that you would want, including Pashmina, from the lay market. And then on day 9 is the final day. Of course, this is departure. So, you know, I love this picture of these kids because sometimes when you go to these remote areas, you think, you know, will kids pose or, you know, what is the kind of reactions they'll give? And this is the coolest reaction that we have ever got with the super cool kids. And, you know, that's just them bidding farewell to us. So, yep, day 9 is the last day. And that's once job well done and you guys get back to your homes and get back to your normal lives. And hopefully the entire journey brings about a certain change in you as a person, or you know, is able to, in fact, one of the things that it really does is connects you to Skitmung Fu Nunnery. So 5 years down the line, you're still connected with Skitmung Fu Nunnery. So it's now become part of your story as an individual and as a team together. And so that's the entire journey. Now, in terms of the weather conditions, because so what has happened now is it's already September ending, and it's already gone to sub-zero in Leh, and we will be you know, in the valley, so it will be much more colder. So I would recommend all of you to get in as much winter gear as possible. Just refer to the document we have shared on Trek Essentials, but add a couple of more thermals and you know, sweaters or a down jacket if you can. And also, everyone needs to have trekking shoes. So please don't get sport shoes. We need proper trekking shoes. If you don't have them, buy them now and break them in. What you don't want is brand new shoes and then get blisters on your feet once you're trekking. So that would be not a good thing to have. So buy your trekking shoes if you haven't and just wear them in. In terms of sleeping bag, please get a minus 10. Anything above minus 10 is good, but at least a minus 10. In the document, we have written a minus 5. But we would recommend a minus 10 degrees Celsius sleeping bag for you so that you are comfortable and warm. And of course, get gloves with you. Gloves, a warm woolen winter cap, and you know, warm woolen socks. And like I said, thermals, your trekking shoes, and sunscreen. So, and sunscreen and sunglasses, because even though it is cold, there is very harsh sunlight. So if you want to avoid a sunburn, I recommend getting a SPF 50 or above for the sunscreen. And in terms of the logistics, like I said, so we have a hotel in Leh, which will have central heating, so you'll be warm. And in the Nunnery, we'll put you in a place where it is warm and has a space heating solution, which we'll figure out once we are there. But you'll be kept warm. And with regards to any anything else, I think that's about it. I'll in fact now open it up for question and answers to hear more from all of you if you have any questions.
Yeah. Hi, Jody. Quick question. I've been to Leh before last year, January, for a trek as well. And I know that the flights usually tend to get cancelled quite often. I don't know if it's the weather in October is bad enough for cancellations. But how are we planning to manage that?
Yeah, thanks for the question. In fact, October, there are no cancellations. October, November, in fact, even December, there's zero cancellations because the weather is clear. January, because of the snowfall, the flights get cancelled, January, February. But October, there's no cancellations. So that's not a concern.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Hi, Paras. This is Elizabeth from the Netherlands. I have a question, a few questions. I will be arriving a day early in May. Will you be able to share the hotel details where we, so I can book an extra night?
Yeah, sure. I think I already, this is Jaydeep here. I already replied to, I think, Ilse or to you that we will share the hotel details in a couple of days. And so you can book the extra night there.
Second question, at the nunnery, will it be possible to power the phone and cameras, or should we bring power banks?
Thank you so much for that question. So in the nunnery, there won't be any power for charging your phones or cameras. So if you are planning to document it and take a lot of pictures, I would recommend getting extra batteries for your camera. And once we leave from day, just charge your phone and then have a battery pack with you. But in the nunnery, there won't be any charging facility.
Okay, great. That helps. In your Trek Essentials list, there's quite a few items that you need for camping. How likely is it that we will be camping? If I understood you well, we will be staying at the nunnery, or should we bring all the gear for camping as well?
Can you let me know?
The headlights. I think there were a couple of items.
So the gear that has been mentioned will be valid even if you are not camping, because essentially when we say camping, it will be like staying in the tents. Even if we stay in the rooms of the nuns, you will still need headlamps and all the other things. So whatever is mentioned in the Trek Essentials holds true if you are camping or even if you are not camping.
Okay, that makes sense. Thanks, Jaydeep. Then my last question, is it recommended to bring any gifts? Can we bring anything for the nuns and the students? Or would you say, okay, better not? And if you say yes, what should we bring?
Thanks for that question. If it's okay, I can get back to you on that once I check with the nun association whether it's okay and what kind of gifts are okay for the participants to get for the nuns.
Great. Thanks. Thanks so much, Jaydeep.
I'll take that follow-up.
Great. Thanks. That's all for me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, actually, Jaydeep, how many will we be in the expedition? How big is the group?
So it's 7 to 8 right now. So it might be 7, it might be 8, but that's the number.
Okay.
Also, one more thing, sorry, is if you have any medicines that you're taking, please get them with you, because I'm not sure in Leh you will find those medicines. So if there's any medicines you're taking, please get them with you. We will have a medic along with us in case of any altitude sickness that any of you might develop. So we have all those precautions taken care of. But if there's any medicine that you're taking traditionally, please get them along. And also, we have shared a medical form. It would be great if you can fill it up, get it signed by a doctor and send it back to us so that we are aware if there's any specific medical condition we need to watch out for.
Great.
Jaydeep, sorry, Hima here again. A quick question. Do you recommend using Dymox because it's slightly on a higher altitude, or it's okay because we're not going to be hiking much and we have enough time to acclimatize?
So thanks, Hima, for the questions. For everyone, Dymox is a diuretic tablet that is taken by people before coming to higher altitude. Essentially, what the medicine does is drains all the fluid out of your lungs so that your lungs' oxygen carrying capacity increases. Now, what we recommend is not to take Dymox and acclimatize naturally, because it helps the body better. And if there is any, and we of course have oxygen meters with us in Leh, we keep a check on your oxygen levels. And if we feel someone is not able to acclimatize naturally, we will give you Dymox there. And as you mentioned that, you know, we have 2 days of acclimatization, so which is good enough for people to get used to the high altitude. And but if, like I said, if there's any emergency, we have the medicines, and we also have oxygen cylinders with us for the extreme cases. So, but typically, we have seen people acclimatize naturally much better.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Hi, Jaideep. Netra here.
Yeah.
You mentioned about minus 10 degree sleeping bag. So is it available on Amazon? Where can I get it? I'm just wondering.
Netra, since you're from India, you can go to Decathlon, to any of the Decathlon stores and get a minus 10 degree bag, sleeping bag.
Okay. Okay.
Basically, wherever you are, if you go to any of these outdoor sports or camping stores, you can easily get a minus 10 degrees Celsius sleeping bag. And of course, when all of you come there, on the first day, our team will do a gear check to ensure that you have all the right things. And if you find anything missing in terms of some of the basic things, you might still be able to find it in Leh. But things like, let's say, a minus 10 degree sleeping bag, you won't be able to find in Leh. So it's better you buy it and carry it along with you, or rent it, whatever works. So if there are no other questions, yep, I think thank you everyone for joining in, and thank you everyone for stepping out of your comfort zone and being part of this expedition. And we really look forward to welcoming all of you on the 12th October. And meanwhile, we'll keep sending you any other details that we might have at our end. And Elizabeth, I've already taken the follow up on the gifts. We'll check it and get back to you.
Great. Thank you so much. Really looking forward.
Thanks, Jaideep.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.